late, there is a lot of buzz about privatization of public sector banks. There have been several reports in the media about the future of central banks. Social media too is a buzz, with several forwards doing the rounds asking people to be careful of their deposits. Such fears, though, are mostly unfounded. Though there have been reports about possible privatization of banks in India, there have been no concrete announcements apart from an indication from the Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman way back in May. In a privatization scenario, the government will always retain a portion of the bank's stake and as such will remain a shareholder. Whenever bulk withdrawal of deposits takes place, the government as a shareholder will step in to adequately capitalize the bank. Meanwhile, an RBI board member has said public sector banks should not be privatized given the country's developmental needs, but the government can look at reducing its shareholding to 26% by selling a larger portion of its stake. In this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze the road ahead for public sector banks. Joining me on the program today are Dr. Aruna Sharma, Member, Digitization Committee, RBI; Ajay Shankar, former Secretary, DIPP, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India; and Chibuwai Bhattacharji, Consulting Editor of the Business Standard. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. So Dr. Sharma, I'd like to begin the program with you first. Let's understand and try and, you know, figure out this whole, you know, thing that's going on about privatization of public sector banks. There's so much of information, there's so many media reports surrounding the same. What are your thoughts on privatization of public sector banks?
If you look at the public sector bank, you know, if you go to the genesis of it, that why those banks were nationalized, it was basically to give a push to the targeted programs of the government and then ensure that those targets are fulfilled and banks are pushed and they have these targets and in their credit plan, they have to honor it. From there, we have come a long way. At that time, we didn't have so much of penetration of the banks. Now you have both the banks and non-bank institutions. So you have the NBFCs and microfinance institutions, as well as you have rural banks. Now post office also has got a bank license, and they will also be stepping in into giving credits in the future. So they'll graduate from payment banks to others. The cooperative banks have also come onto the digital mode, that is the CBS platform, as we go ahead. So under this scenario, now the penetration is very, very high. And why this whole debate started off for the PSBs to be privatized was because what came up in standing committee was of high NPA, which they were having, of, you know, if you look at the government policies, then CRAR rates were very high then, or the PCA, what they have to put, was very high. So banks were not left with larger liquidity to lend. But now recently, you must have seen post-COVID, there has been a lot of corrections where the reverse repo rate has been brought down. So the banks have more liquidity and you are able to lend more. But the negative part of it is the banks are suffering through the fear factor that they are not lending because of the NPAs, because of the NCLT, because of the action taken against some of the bank officers, which could have been mala fide or bona fide. That instead of, you know, that gap has got blurred. So in the sense, they are going for a safer deposit. And even though reverse repo rate has come down, banks have preferred to put more and more money with the RBI. So in this, the whole debate started off whether it makes sense to privatize it. Now, it has to be taken with a pinch of salt. You have a Yes Bank where RBI had to step in to salvage it. So you have a case of a private bank where the equity has to be increased. The, you know, the equity were purchased by the organizations or public sector units or a public sector bank, as well as the RBI to salvage Yes Bank. And on other side, we are going in for the mergers of the banks which were not performing or did not have a good asset value. So in this scenario, now to talk about this privatization, I think it is too early. We have to stabilize where we are. We have to stabilize this entire hierarchy of banks we have created, started from banks to small banks to now post banks, the cooperative banks getting into the fray, then NBFC, MFI, non-banking, in a big way into the credit lines. So I think all this needs to be stabilized very, very well as we are moving ahead. And once it stabilizes, only then we can think of somebody who is ready to purchase a big stake. Even if it's 26% government wants to deduce, it's not a small money which somebody will have to put to buy the equity. And we did not find any private sector coming in to salvage Yes Bank. So it's all hypothetical. That's what I strongly feel at this stage. So better to consolidate what various steps have been taken at this moment of time instead of jumping the bus.
Okay. Let me take a couple of points forward with the other panelists as well. Let's first talk about consolidation. You know, Mr. Shankar, do you believe that we need to see more banks being amalgamated, more consolidation of public sector banks rather than privatization, something that we've seen of late? What has the experience been?
I would agree with the previous panelists that this is not the time to look, in my view, at any privatization, because the economy is in a very difficult position. The coming weeks and months may be more difficult. So right now, there may be no appetite at all for anybody to pick up stakes in any disinvestment or privatization, unless we are looking at selling something very cheaply to a foreign institution. And even there, I'm not sure whether the appetite will be there today, given the analysis and assessment of where the Indian economy is going. So the other thing which I think the Yes Bank episode has brought very starkly, that the political reality of India is such that at the end of the day, government does need to ensure that all bank depositors get their money back, whether they are ordinary deposits or fixed deposits. I think the political reality of India will not allow the government to sit by finally and let a bank fail and bank depositors lose all their money. I think that is not possible. So I think the necessity to go back and rethink the basics, that we increase RBI supervision or whatever we do, but we make sure that all banks are able to assure their depositors that their money is safe, and the RBI and the sovereign, which is the government, is behind all banks. Once you take that position, then I think one needs to look at all of things in a slightly different model. The problem with public sector banks is of two kinds. One is a professionalization of management, and which would be necessary even if the equity is drawn down to 26% or something. And there are issues of, I think one reference was made by the last panelist, that you have to get rid of the fear factor. So I should be very confident, and the bank should be made confident, and all officials should be made confident, that in future, if a loan has gone bad, if I have not personally gained from that loan, quid pro quo or a bribe, I will be presumed to be innocent, and I should be very confident that no investigating agency would hold me guilty of any conspiracy. If I have gained, I should go to. But that clear message is certainly needed if banks start getting confidence back in lending, and lending with vigor. Related to this are two other ideas whose time has come. One is to take out all the policy-related NPAs from the books of the banks and put them in a bad bank, usually the power sector and other infrastructure loans. The balance are part of the normal market, and if promoters have to become bankrupt or asset sales take place, it is fine. But the infrastructure sector certainly deserves a different treatment. The banks shouldn't have gone in the first place. We should have had a long-term development financial institutions which provided long-term credit to power projects and highway projects. We didn't do that. This time we took it out, took a hard view of what right now are required and what long-term restructuring is required, and let the banks do normal commercial lending for normal industrial activity. Time has come to have a bad bank, let all these infrastructure assets go there, and then have, again, the idea of asset restructuring the management company, you take them over and manage it. So like one idea which I have been advocating for some time, that you take all of the real estate companies, all the developers are bankrupt, you all own land banks, just nationalize them, inject fresh equity, complete all the projects, give the buyers their flats, sit on the land bank in a few years' time when the economy recovers, it'll be a huge value, and only the sovereign and the state can do it. the IBC process will not lead to the completion of all the housing projects which are abandoned with the new feature. If you take it over today, restructure all the construction contracts in 2 months, you will give the biggest stimulus to the economy in the short term. But okay, you need to nationalize, you will need to inject equity, the sovereign stands behind the new CEO, the old management is injected, and work starts on all the project. 3-4 years down the road, can take a view what ahead, what kind of.
These are some really good ideas and thoughts that you're bringing in. Remains to be seen whether or not it can actually be implemented and whether it will be done. Of course, you need the will as well to go ahead with something like this. There have been several reforms that have taken place. Let's hope that these reforms do take place sometime in the near future. Talking about fear now, let me take up this issue of fear one by one with the two panelists, because there are two types of fears. One, of course, the fear that the previous two speakers have already spoken about, Shubhamoy. You know, as far as lending from the banks is concerned, how do we get rid of that fear? How do we ensure that the banks, you know, feel freer to lend money to those who need it?
You know, Frank, such a honestness with banks. There's so many issues that we can actually have a month of debate on banking sector. There's, I mean, and each one is big, each one, like the fear factor. I am of the opinion that no matter whatever one does, in a state-run operation, just as one can give out loans without any care about tomorrow, similarly, there can be fear about every loan that is given. Every finance minister for the last 20 years has tried to tell bankers that don't worry, go ahead, go do sound commercial loans. And every banker will be able to tell us about cases where their colleagues or they themselves have been hounded. Frankly speaking, it is something that cannot be taken out of the state-run banking system. It is impossible to lay down rules. It's impossible to say that this loan will not come back to us. And the way to go about it is then why, what is, that is the primary reason, in fact, one of the two primary reasons why state-run banks are frankly not a pleasant circumstance to be had in the current banking scenario now, in past or in the future. You cannot have government running businesses. This should not be conflated with the fact that the government has to be the wicket keeper or the net to ensure that the safety depositors. That is ensured in any case by the Deposit, Credit and Guarantee Insurance Corporation. You have that to ensure. And that's for every bank. So the government doesn't need to stand as an additional support to ensure the depositors' money are kept safe. The point about why private banks are able to keep their NPA within reasonable limits, whereas state bank run banks get into trouble, is because of the fact that it is impossible for any bank. For instance, supposing there's a loan given out, does one know if it comes, if it goes south, a banker can say, I was asked to. And if the loan, and in the reverse case, the prosecuting agency can say the due diligence was not done. Because what is due diligence is an extremely subjective decision. How is it able to be, how can you separate the two? It is for the bank's shareholders to decide. The bank shareholders, if it happens to be the same, that is the government, then there is obviously a conflict of interest. And this conflict can never be settled by allowing state-run banks to continue. A need for a development financial institution, as Dr. Ajeshan rightly pointed out, is absolutely correct. But that is a different category than banks. If a bank has to run and it has not got to be periodically bailed out by taxpayers' money, then the bank must run on commercial principles. And on commercial principles, it can today, for instance, one can say that, for instance, Dr. Sharma pointed out that Yes Bank failed. Yes, Yes Bank failed, but in Yes Bank's failure is not a taxpayers' problem. If Yes Bank today, for instance, is on the upside, Moody's has upgraded its fortune. Why is it? Because it's turned around with a sound commercial principle. Commercial taxpayers do not have to come into it. But if taxpayers have to come into it to bail out a bank repeatedly, then there is a problem, and that is what is happening. And why should this happen? Because remember, the taxpayer also happens to be the poorest who do not necessarily go to the bank. So we are ensuring a unfair call that the same money which should be going to, for instance, in this time when we are talking about migrant laborers being at the bad end of the stick, they need stimulus. Why should that money instead be going to recapitalize banks? There is a problem there which is not easily understood, and this is where the problem comes in. Banks have to run on commercial principles, and if they cannot be run on commercial principles, then they have no business to be existing, and least of all, the government does not have the right to run a bank. The last point, which is that about the 26% thing. I think that 26% point is a very dangerous one. Why? Because either somebody who owns a bank should run, if it is going to be run by government, yet with just 26%, then we are introducing an element of risk, which means that even though the majority shareholder is somebody else, but the government will exercise the right to veto, which is a dangerous principle. It will actually further erode the bank's ability to run as a commercial entity. Responsibility must lie with the extent of shareholding. That is the fundamental principle.
Okay, points taken. Now, let me take another, since we're talking about fear factor, let me talk about another fear from the other side as well. You know, there is the sense of fear amongst the public, Dr. Sharma, you know, about what is going to happen to their hard-earned money that they have deposited in the banks. You know, is it safe? Is it not safe? People have seen what has happened with the Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank as well. So that is on their, that is also fresh on their minds. So how do you deal with the fear factor as far as the public is concerned?
Very rightly said, because recent amendments is now protecting 5 lakhs of your rupees of the account holder. So that is the only insurance cover that is available as on date. So even if you have fixed deposits more than 5 lakhs of rupees or savings account more than that, then the in case of entire liquidity of the banks, the only insured amount will be to the upper cap of 5 lakhs of rupees. That is how it stands legally today. And the way the PMC happened and sudden lockdown and people allowed to withdraw only a very tiny limited amount for an extended time has created this fear factor among the depositors that will their money be safe with the banks? Will their money be more safe with cooperative banks, more safe with the private banks, or the safest with the public sector banks? So this kind of a thought process have gone into the minds of the people where they should put their money, their hard-earned money, the money if they want to tap as per their requirement, immediate access when they are moving ahead. And if somebody has examined that now post-COVID, suddenly the investments, the small investor investments in the share market is going up. So that also shows that people are wondering about their portfolios, about where to park their money, where to go about. And India with not a very strong social protection mechanisms, where the healthcare, the old age care has to be done based on your savings, your deposits, and that is where the people tap into. Therefore, you know, this fear factor, it becomes much larger, much bigger, and much worrisome to the people. They want their hard-earned money and government to have an umbrella cover to protect it completely in case something goes wrong with the bank and the bank operates it wrong. And the case which you very rightly said about the Punjab Maharashtra Cooperative Bank, it was the failure of the regulators to monitor the kind of lending they were doing. There was a huge chunk of lending that was done, and maybe it was camouflaged, they were not able to pinpoint it, and it led to a disaster of the honest depositors who had their hard-earned money put there. And the situation in the public image became worse when few of them died, and that death reports were very strongly reflected in the media. So in the sense, you know, the people started wondering whether their money is safe with the banks, whether they can tap the money, like I said before, as and when they want, whenever they require. So this kind of a fear factor is there, and the solution for that is this 5 lakh of rupees needs to be constantly enhanced further. There has to be a secured guarantee. There could be a small insurance premium of less than 10 rupees, because looking at the amount of bank deposits, the premium will come out very small and it can be insured very well. So that kind of a policy is a must for people to come out of this fear factor, so that they know their money in the deposits, in whatever form it is safe, and they can tap it whenever needed, even though the bank may get liquidated or may become kaput, and suddenly, you know, they are put into an unfortunate situation where they are not able to tap their own money. And this is very important for a robust economy, for an economy where you have maximum percentage in middle class and below the poverty line range, where it becomes a very critical factor. And that criticality will have to be understood, and therefore it is very important to come with this umbrella kind of an insurance coverage, which is much more robust when we are going ahead and we want to overcome this particular fear factor as we are working.
Absolutely. All right, let me bring in some history into the picture as well. You know, Mr. Sharma, since inception, no formal nationalized bank has collapsed. So if you look at history, it seems to be in our favor, and that is one good thing. And like Dr. Sharma has said, probably we just need to enhance, the way we look at the insurance cover and bring in a few more aspects so that we can, we can make the depositors sleep easy.
No, but then,
I'm talking to Mr. Shankar. Mr. Shankar, go ahead.
Yeah.
I would say that you need full insurance for all deposits in all banks, whether they're public sector or private sector. If the depositor has to pay an insurance premium, he should be given the option. It should be mandatory that he pay that premium. And if it is felt that if you have a deposit over a crore, it should not be insured, then the bank should not accept a deposit above that amount. But I think if you want to restore faith in the average individual in India who's not into stocks and those kinds of saving instruments or investment instruments, he needs this assurance as soon as possible. And it should not be difficult, because everything in the world is insured. This can be insured. The other is that the supervisory role of the RBI has to be more inclusive and more effective, so that the confidence of the public that another yes bank will occur is reduced. So people feel that this kind of thing won't easily happen. And one way of doing that would be to also bring in place a development financial institution as soon as possible and take out all of these infrastructure and those kind of loans, where the banks can legitimately claim that this is a policy induced or a structural problem in the economy. There's no way I could have done this kind of due diligence. And I have a slight difference of opinion on the issue of building in confidence in bankers. All that is required is to drop criminal investigations into those bank officials where no quid pro quo has been found in 2 years' time. So just have a review of all cases under investigation by CBI and ED. If in 2 years, give them the investigation agencies another 6 months, find a Swiss bank account, find a Benami property or another quid pro quo. You can't find it, close the case. The day 10 such places are closed, all bankers will listen to finance ministers' exhortations. Till that happens, no matter what speeches we give, they will continue to be paid. And the fact of the matter is that any commercial decision, and all bank loans are commercial decisions, they are based on judgments. You will always go wrong in some cases. It has happened through history, it has happened across the world. So any case that goes wrong, if I start with the presumption that there was some malafide, there was some conspiracy, there was some corruption, then all kinds of innocent people are put under stress, and their colleagues learn the lesson that don't do anything.
Okay. All right. So Shubham, I close the show for us with the concluding remarks on the best way forward. And, you know, several, measures have been taken, several reforms have been undertaken in the recent past as far as banking is concerned. What more needs to be done going forward, do you think?
I think the government is doing the right way by saying that working out the list of strategic sectors And I think it's going to say basically that banking is not a strategic sector, which is very good. Because essentially, you need to be clear that any sector performs best when sectors are allowed to work on commercial principles. And that is what the government is strongly moving towards, which is an extremely good idea. Also, the idea that the government is saying that banks need to perform on the basis of what the sound commercial principles is again a wonderful thing. And I think the, both of those are well taken point. The third point is no Indian, the problems of what we were talking right now was of credit problem and of deposit problem. The credit problem is an entirely different one to be handled by ensuring, as Mr. Ajay Shankar is talking about, ensuring that there's a connectivity between who gives the loan and under what circumstances. The interest of depositors is a totally different thing. The government of India allows for a universal insurance cover for every bank's loan, every bank's deposit. Any bank, wherever anybody has put money in, up to 5 lakh, whether it's private sector or public sector, is insured. The point is that it might be needed to take it forward. Up to what amount is a call to be taken by the government, by the people. I mean, that's to be decided on. But once we can separate these two, then I suppose we'll have much more clarity. The reason why Yes Bank is a success in terms of the recapitalization and PMC is a disaster shows that when RBI is the boss, it works. When RBI isn't the boss, there's a problem. PMC was not under RBI. It was run by state governments, remember. There was a dual control, which has now been shifted to RBI. And we shall therefore not have such sorry cases of urban cooperative banks running their depositors to ground. Thank you.
I've got a little more time left on the program. So, Dr. Sharma, you can close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
I'll just like to make a mention that, repeating, that this is not the right time to go for privatization of the public sector banks for the simple reason that you are in a very big way working on the penetration part of it, which is not yet complete. And there are lots of problems into it. And then the government is also thinking of, you know, the RBI control mechanisms to be improving further, which is still not seen. A very robust platform put, so it is going to take a year or so for us to move ahead with that. Mm-hmm. Then on the other hand, you're having a merger in a very, very big way. So merger itself is a big HR nightmare, and let that be sorted out before any private sector will even think of putting their hand there.
Right.
There was mention by Mr. Ajay Shankar very rightly said that policy induced failure. Because if you look at, if you do the diagnosis of many of the NPAs, there has been some somersault of the policies. The policies will have to take that blame to some extent where our consistency and credibility has not happened over past maybe 1.5 decade or so. So that is very, very important when we are going ahead, and whether it is a private bank or whether it is a public sector bank, policy-induced upsetting a sector has to be avoided when we are going ahead, because that really sort of hits it very, very badly.
All right. On that note, then, I'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. So what's coming out of this discussion is that we need to get rid of the fear factor and ensure that banks can lend more freely. But that is easier said than done, because this is something that governments have been trying to do for a few decades now, but have not been fully successful. Talking about fear factor, there's the fear factor on the other side as well. Remember, the PMC collapse has instilled a sense of fear in the depositors as well. Deposits up to 5 lakh rupees are protected as of now. But remember one thing, history tells us,